I'm sorry, that might have been for myself. But no, seriously, how many of you are employed? How many of you are working at jobs that you loved in the beginning, but later on down the road didn't like? What were the reasons? Was it the job itself, discrimination, coworkers, pay, favoritism, all of the above, yet did you still remain? Somewhere in life, we have all been in a place where we may have felt stagnant. So as you have guessed, today's TED Talk will be about nepotism. Let me tell you about my first experience. My first job was Chick-fil-A. Everyone loves Chick-fil-A. I mean, who doesn't? Well, I started at Chick-fil-A in Morristown, Tennessee at the age of 15. This was my first job, and I was so excited about having my own money. I worked at this location for about a year before my mom's job decided they were going to relocate her to Thomasville, Georgia, our hometown. I love my job. I love my boss, my coworkers, and the numerous raises I was receiving. Customers were always raving about me, and Chick-fil-A was more like a family versus a team. How can I give this up? Before I could ask, my boss ensured that I should transfer to the Chick-fil-A there, and he told me he would put in a good word for me. So I went through the process, and to fast forward a little bit, I was hired on at that Chick-fil-A in my hometown. But the operator there started me at a lower pay than what I was receiving in the previous store. But at that moment, I really didn't care. I love what I did, and you know the saying, if you do what you've always done, you will get what you've always gotten. I figured I did what I was already doing, there would be no problem getting a raise. I was always that employee that took my job to heart. I was always helping others, exceeding the expectations of the customers, willing to learn and do every job, eager to stay there and work overtime, and always being readily available when needed. This is what we would call voluntary cooperation, a person who does above and beyond. I worked at this store for about 8 years, and every year I hated it more and more. Out of those years, I was only given a dollar raise. Yes, only a dollar raise. Considering my work ethic, I should have been getting more. And those that had a poor work ethic, didn't do nearly as much, they were getting more. And I just felt like I was overqualified. Yes, I was receiving the least pay. So, as you have guessed again, of course, they were family members and relatives, and nepotism was present. So, the turnover rate had begun to get high. If you think about it, when a company experiences pay rate issues, it's due to three perspectives. I like to call them PEN, P-E-N, because this is something that should be noted. P stands for pay inequality due to race and gender, E stands for economy, and N stands for nepotism. Have you ever heard the saying, this is a man's job? For that reason, sometimes women may not seem as the ideal candidate, and for that reason, they're usually compensated likewise. Did you know that women managers who work full-time are paid 22% less than men? And they are effectively unpaid for 1 hour and 40 minutes every day, or they work 57 days out of a year for free. Most of the time in the economy, you might not get paid as much because there are detrimental acquisitions. And for instance, you may have a person that wants to work in a particular career field, but they can't because the economy does not allocate enough funds for them to go on their well-being. So next we have nepotism. This is one of the most common forms. Nepotism is a way to show a deteriorating work culture. It's really the power and influence of having relatives being hired and getting certain jobs, or you can say it's favoritism based on kinship. Sometimes individuals are not always hired or promoted for the right reasons. A person may get hired or promoted and may not be qualified to get that position. Today, one of the most unrelated positions being filled is one of those that are receiving higher pay and they are getting not as much education or the skills or the ability to fill the position. And again, this has been an experience of nepotism. There has been an instance where a boss hired someone and a person felt as though they were more qualified and an undeserving employee got it, but they didn't say anything because nepotism present, and most people don't know how to handle it. So once in my experience with Chick-fil-A, I'm dating back to employees that work in businesses, most times a company is affected by an employee that is experiencing nepotism, and I was one of them. I only did my job description, my work efficiency, I no longer made myself really available, and this is what we will call compulsory cooperation. And this is what I do, what I require, and nothing extra. I despise going to work most days, but I went anyway because this is my sole survivor of living. Nepotism is present in my current workplace as well. I was hired in a position salary for less than $30,000. Yet I accepted it because it was an entry-level position, the benefits, and it was potential for both within the company. I had 2 years of experience, a bachelor's degree, and I had to see the expectations of the required knowledge, skills, and abilities to fill the position. I was a superior candidate. I was the same as I was to Chick-fil-A. I did it above and beyond my job description. I was volunteered to help different departments, and I agreed, but it was more so like voluntold. But I did it anyway because I felt like it would help me in promotional ventures. Well, the boyfriend of a supervisor's niece who hired in the same position, He started this job salary at $40,000. So who's really winning here? Is it better to be overqualified yet underpaid, or better to be hired or promoted because of a relative or who you know within the company? So once other employees notice that there have been hiring and promotional process in the organization that it seems to be unfair, it affects the employee and it affects the business. An employee may be impacted by nepotism by becoming dissatisfied with the company. If a person is dissatisfied with the company, they'll react by putting a sour taste in the mouth of new employees. What I mean by this is they'll tell bad stories about the company, they'll tell malicious stories about employees, they even make up things to make you feel like this is not a place you want to be. Basically, creating a bad work culture. Nepotism can also be the result of desertion, alienation, frustration when a promotion is being involved and they have been waiting for this promotion, but an undeserving coworker gets it instead. It takes a toll on the employee's physical and mental state. It creates a stressful work environment, and it also creates resentment towards the manager. It may even allow them to engage in unethical practices. A business, on the other hand, can also be impacted by the result of high turnover rate, high absenteeism rate. The morale of the company can be lowered. It can create a bad work culture. It can reduce productivity, and it can create a breach of confidentiality. It can also be a financial burden. A business may not be able to afford demand because of lack of labor force, or it can be costly to lose employees. So there are five ways to handle nepotism in the workplace. First, observe the employees that are working. You should know any irregularities. You should know whether it is important dates, whether it is dialogue, whether it is circumstances that are surrounding the event, and even any witnesses that can support your idea. Second, if you're hiring manager, evaluate the candidates who can demonstrate the skills and qualifications to perform the job. This is important, especially if you're asked to consider a hiring relative or of an current employee. For instance, nepotism may not be a valid concern if the person is actually qualified to fulfill the job. Third, discuss your concerns with the HR department or the company's top manager. It is prevalent to be professional. Be mindful of the company's owner because they may have a relative that you may be working in that position. Also, it's important to check your feelings. Be sure that your standpoint is not about personal feelings or nepotism. It's merely about how it can affect the accountability of the business and not more so a personal level or your personal feelings about nepotism. Fourth, consider the family relationship. Is it a business where this is family owned and the family is helping the professional development of that person? And you can consider the relative standpoint within this position. Fifth, if you have the authority to propose and implement a company policy, draft the policy that prevents a family member or spouse from being the direct supervisor over that person. This is key because it offers many advantages if you recommend this policy. If you recommend this policy, you will be able to lessen the ability of not having nepotism in your workplace. You'll also be able to conduct things where you'll be able to get feedback, candid feedback, without feeling like you're hurting their feelings. And you're also showing the employees that you're valuing them. It is vital to create a business environment where employees are valued and compensated for their work ethic and contribution to any organization. This in turn will benefit the firm as well as the employee. So creating a groundbreaking work culture can be what delineates a substantial and efficacious organization. As the phenomenal author Toni Morrison once stated, everyone gets everything handed to them, the rich inherited it. I don't mean just the inheritance of money, but I mean what people take for granted among the middle and upper classes, which is nepotism, the old boy nepotism.